this is how it started.
Out on the plains, down your Santa Fe, I met a cowboy right in the range one day, and as he jogged along,
maybe that voice brings back memories to you. The time was 1942, remember? The place, Hollywood. The setting, well, the world was at war. The weather was hot, and the St. Louis Cardinals were preparing to tee off against the New York Yankees in the climactic World Series. Yes, 10 years ago, a decade. You were probably humming tunes like Don't Sit Under the Apple Tree, Tangerine, and the Jersey Bounce on your way to work or school.
Singing it's cocktail, boogie in the strangest way. Come a tie, aye, aye, aye.
Ella Mae Morse, Freddie Slack's music, and the Cow Cow Boogie. That did it. That's the combination that launched a big new thing. A performance that affected millions of people the world over. And how about this one? That rings a bell, too, hmm? Of course, it's the Elks Parade, and it rang the bell to fame and fortune for young Bobby Sherwood, whose struggling young band produced it.
Oh, she hates corny waltzes, and she hates the gavotte. And there's one big advantage if the music's hot. It's a fast-moving exit just in case something rips. So the band plays the polka while she strips.
Hey, the strip polka with Johnny Mercer.
It's the best in the West.
Take it off, take it off, take it off.
You can yell like the rest.
Take her out when it's over.
She's a peach when she's dressed.
But she stops, and always just in time, time, time.
Queenie, queen of them all. Queenie, someday you fall. Someday church bells will chime.
Quang, quang. In strip polka time, church bells will chime. In strip polka time.
And there you have three records, all released on the same day by the same company in that same August of 1942. And thus was born Capitol Records. Maybe just a week or so ago you read that article in a national news magazine in which Capitol's president, Glenn E. Wallichs, was directly quoted about Capitol's start. I can't seem to find the clipping, but if memory serves, Mr. Wallichs recalled that...
I happened to be operating a music and record store at the time, and Johnny Mercer was a regular customer of the shop. Occasionally, while browsing around listening to new records, he'd even buy one. But seriously, Johnny commented frequently about various recording artists and the songs on records, and I recall how we both agreed that there just might be room for a new company. The more we talked, the more enthused we became. And shortly, with a very big assist from the late motion picture and stage producer and songwriter, Buddy DeSylva, Johnny Mercer and I rented office space and founded Capitol Records. Cow Cow Boogie, Elks Parade, and Strip Polka were immediate hits. But Capitol had its problems nonetheless. It takes tons of shellac to manufacture phonograph records, and because of the war, shellac was virtually impossible to obtain in any quantity. On top of that problem, the musicians' union decided to call a strike, and professional musicians were not allowed to make records of any kind after July 31st. The next year, 1943, was a tough one for Mercer, DeSylva, and Wallichs, and the tiny group of Capitol people who were fighting to keep the young company alive. But somehow, Capitol not only survived, but began to prosper in a big way, especially after the union ended its strike late in 1943.
Will I ever find the boy in my mind, the one who is my ideal?
The tender voice of Margaret Whiting, just a timid little teenager when she recorded My Ideal, her father's song, with Billy Butterfield for the Young Cap label. This had been recorded just before the union strike, but it became a big seller while the strike was on in that summer of 43. And did you know that trumpeter Butterfield, on this side with Maggie, actually was conducting the Les Brown Band of Renown? Billy didn't have a band of his own at that time.
When you raise your eyes and make believe, all the stars come out and paint a world of blue. There's my heart right up your sleeve, waiting all for you.
All for you. And when Nat King Cole sings or pounds a piano keyboard, he does it all for you, just for you. This was the first King Cole trio record for Capitol, and it was a big success. They wore the surface off this one, as you can hear. Cole had made a dozen flops for another company earlier in his career, but, well, this one seemed to have it. It's still 1943, and business is good. Came October of that year in another World Series. The same Cardinals and Yankees at it again. And just as the season ended, came another hit platter from Hollywood.
This is the G.I. Jive, Man Alive. It starts with the bugler blowing reveille over your bed when you arrive. Jack, that's the G.I. Jive. Rootledy-toot, jump in your suit, make a salute. Voot!
Voot! That Mercer man again, and this one he composed himself. He got the idea, he says, while waiting for a traffic light to turn green. Well, that's what the man said. G.I. Jive was a smash. The world was G.I. conscious, and it marked the first hit Capitol disc after America's musicians resumed recording following their strike of more than a year. Let's have a bit more of this man, Mercer, this songwriting, singing co-founder of Capitol Records, with Paul Weston's music backstopping Johnny's barbecued baritone.
Seems you're right back digging that G.I. Jive.
Long about this time, a whole batch of up-and-coming young artists were signed for recording sessions. Joe Stafford, the Pied Pipers, Julia Lee, Eddie Miller, Benny Carter, and a big, tall piano player who smacked a four-bagger his first time up. Listen. Artistry and Rhythm by Stan Kenton. You'll remember his own Eager Beaver click. It came out in June of 1944, and within just a few weeks, it had boosted Kenton to a ledge in the orchestra field as high as the spot that Glenn Miller, Harry James, Artie Shaw, the Dorseys, and Benny Goodman had occupied before him. A break? Luck? Well, while Eager Beaver was riding high, and GIs and Navy men were singing the riff all over the world that summer, Kenton came out with still another bell ringer with the help of vocalist Anita O'Day. Come on in. You can clap your hands on this one.
And when his wife said, hey now, what did you get for me? He socked her in the choppers. Such a sweet, sweet guy was he.
And her tears flowed like wine. Yes, her tears flowed like wine.
Well, over on the big Paramount lot in Hollywood, an uninhibited little blonde who had deserted the Vincent Lopez Orchestra not long before was tabbed by Buddy DeSylva and other picture executives as a coming star. Her name was Betty Hutton, and she grabbed herself a big, big hit record doing a routine precisely like this.
Tell the duck to stick to his practice. Tell the
lawyer
to saddle his keys. Send the
engine chief.
And it's Tommy Hawk.
Doctor, lawyer, Indian chief, a rousing sleeper novelty which just kept selling, not like hotcakes, but like the best-selling record that it really was. Betty enjoyed another big one in His Rocking Horse Ran Away, and Stan Kenton racked up his third straight hit on Tampico. Johnny Mercer added two more successes with Accentuate the Positive and On the Atchison, Topeka, and Santa Fe. And finally, Freddie Slack's scintillating Steinway scored again, too, on Cuban Sugar Mill. But of all these, the record still spun most frequently at this late date had a sound. A sound you'll recall with possibly a memory or two.
Dream when you're feeling blue.
Well, it's a pleasure to list the credits on this one. Stanley Reitzman at the Celeste, Eddie Miller's golden tenor saxophone, the Pied Piper sing, Paul Weston conducts, and once again, Johnny Mercer had written a hit song, Dream, Dream.
Dreams never are as bad as they seem, so
or maybe you prefer to remember composer Mercer singing with these same Pied Pipers, Junie Hutton, and Weston's music as they did when they made the first capital hit of 1946. Here's a record with real personality.
Tell me how you like my
personality.
Baby, you've got the cutest
personality.
Few were surprised when the King Cole Trio bobbed up with a bestseller in For Sentimental Reasons, and Ella Mae Morse and Freddie Slack kept pace too with their atmospheric House of Blue Lights Boogie Woogie entry. But this memorable waxing not only came out of left field, it wasn't even in uniform.
Chestnuts roasting on an open fire, Jack Frost nipping at your nose.
Nat Cole had never before recorded with a full-size string section, nor had he ever attempted a seasonal tune like The Christmas Song. But it proved a safe gamble for Cole, and the record, that frosty fall season of 1946 when the St. Louis Cardinals again were baseball champions of the world after lambasting the Boston Red Sox, opened entirely new and exciting horizons for Nat and his warm, expressive baritone voice. Listen again, more carefully now. For this was a 10 strike for Cole and for Capitol, as the alert and growing West Coast firm rounded out its fifth year of operation and became permanently established among the big four of the recording industry.
And so I'm offering this simple phrase to kids from 1 to 92. Although it's been said many times, many ways, Merry Christmas to you.
Now, I'm a feller with a heart of gold, with the ways of a gentleman, I've been told. The kind of a feller that wouldn't even harm a flea. But if me and a certain character met, the guy that invented the cigarette, I'd murder that son of a gun in the first degree.
Smoke that cigarette. Tex Williams puffed this one up and hit the million mark in sales in midsummer of 1947. That's Williams, of course, who's doing the singing. And mentioning singing, remember Red Engel and Cinderella Stump?
Too bored to be kissed, I couldn't resist, 'cause you was temptation.
Joe Stafford of the bell-like tones and the pitch-pipe music gear had the laugh of her life making this vocal with Engel's zany Natural 7. And the world laughed with and at Joe and Red to the tune of a million platters. Maybe it was rhythm that they wanted that summer of 47.
I met a guy while walking down the street. I met a guy while walking down the street. He looked at me, I looked at him. He took my hand, he held my hand. He's a real gone guy and do I love him, deed I do.
Yeah, Nellie Lutcher was just different enough, as all top recording artists must be, to click with her first sides for Capitol. She was signed to a contract after broadcasting over a small West Coast radio station for free in a March of Dimes charity affair. And that same summer, Capitol emerged as a leader within the industry in albums for children, with Alan Livingston's irresistible creation, Bozo the Clown, leading the Muppets' hit parade. And so, with another strike of musicians becoming effective on the last day of 1947, the new year was greeted with a Latin-flavored jingle waxed by Pert Peggy Lee and Dave Barber's band shortly before the strike. Peggy and Dave composed this one themselves. Got your maracas?
Mañana, mañana, mañana is soon enough for me.
My mother's always working, she's working very hard. But every time she looks for me, I'm sleeping in the yard. My mother thinks I'm lazy, and maybe she is right.
Of course, mañana. And with a combined Swedish and Mexican accent, it was Peggy Lee's all-time, all-bestseller. They said back in 48 that it was rhythm that made the hits. And then along came Frank Duvall's flutes and velvety violins and no rhythm at all behind this compelling and familiar voice.
There was a boy, a very strange enchanted boy. They say he wandered very far over land and sea. A little shy and sad of eye, but very wise was he.
Nat Cole, his subtle way of making a subtle lyric plain and understandable and meaningful. Well, the experts decided, now that Nature Boy is a hit with its tender philosophy and its absence of primitive 4/4 beat, the next record will follow the trend. And sure enough, almost on top of the gentle, compassionate Nature Boy came another, an even bigger hit on the Capitol label. Your attention, please. Extreme concentration may be required to fully appreciate the mood expressed by this next gifted conductor, who learned much of his aesthetic skill as a student at the Cincinnati Conservatory of Music. Walter Hunt, they call him Pee-wee, still holds the record for the record, the biggest seller Capitol has had in its 10 years of activity in the industry. And Hunt actually did study music at the Cincinnati Conservatory. 12th Street Rag had been a hit before, but never like this.
By the tree in the meadow, my thoughts always lie, and wherever
Margaret Whiting once again with A Tree in the Meadow. And while it was being spun by the disc jockeys, Maggie W. followed it the following season with another and even bigger record. But now she had a big assist from a friend from Oklahoma.
Oh, you're tied up with someone else, and I'm all tied up too.
I know I've made mistakes, dear,
but I'm so in love with you.
I hope someday I'll find a way to bring you back to me. And I won't have to slip around to have your company.
Jimmy Wakely of the highly polished Boots, teaming with Margaret Whiting on the first of several highly successful biscuits that have won awards from jukebox operators the nation over. Discs that nab the nickels, pull the pesos in every kind of location. from Vermont to Tijuana and Tampa to Tacoma. It now is 1949. And from out of nowhere, that's the same place so many talented, struggling unknowns have come from to make their debut on Capitol Records, came this unique performer along about November.
Jingle bells, jingling all the way. It ain't fun like it used to be in the one horse open.
Yogi Jorgensen caught on first not in Minnesota, but in the great Pacific Northwest, in and near Portland and Seattle. His record was an immediate bestseller there, then it slowly spread across the nation. Oddly enough, Jingle Bells continued as a big hit months after Christmas and clear on around until the following Yuletide. And of course, they love him in Minnesota these days. But now, enter 1950.
Are you warm? Are you real? Mona Lisa. Are just a cold and lonely, lovely work of art.
Ah, whatever your taste in music may be, whatever your preference in songs and in singers, here is a performance which must live in years to come. Nat Cole has enjoyed many successes in his startling career in show business, but none have been, or can ever be, more spectacular, more lasting than his classic recording of Mona Lisa. The conductor is Les Baxter, who earned for himself his own recording contract and a new career with Capitol as a result of his superb talents with Cole on this Academy Award winner. More, Nat, please.
Mona Lisa, Mona Lisa,
K-Star and Tennessee Ernie had both enjoyed some pretty big records before they got together for a duet in a recording studio with I'll Never Be Free.
Yeah! Like a chain bound to my heart, your love remains when we're apart. Each kiss I gave to you
made me a slave to you,
and so I'll never be free.
Kay got her start singing in hillbilly bands in Texas and Tennessee and made her first Capitol Records way back in 1945. Good things like If I Could Be With You, I'll Be Tired of You, I'm the Lonesomest Gal in Town, Faded Summer Love, Please Love Me, So Tired, and Steady Daddy. Ernie came out of the Army and was signed to record as a hillbilly, but his vitality and versatility and all-around virile style appealed to the popular market too. So much so that Capitol was forced to sell many thousands of records by Ernie that they didn't expect to sell originally. His Shotgun Boogie zoomed considerably over the 500,000 mark late in 1950 and kept right on going into 1951, when the very first month brought still another new sound on records, something almost inhuman.
I tore a putty tat a-tweepin' upon me. I tore a putty tat as plain as he could be.
Yep, that's the voice, or one of a thousand voices, of Mel Blanc. Mel, for years, has been featured with Jack Benny and on the soundtracks of hundreds of film cartoons. Putty Tat was an even bigger, longer-lasting hit in England than it was here, and all because of a sound, a different sound. That's what counts on a record. The minute you hear it, you know. The minute you heard this sound, the very first time, you knew. Ready? Well, take a pretty girl, add 6 or 11 guitars, and...
Somewhere there's music, there's...
As I was saying, take a pretty girl, add a few thousand guitars, and you won't even come near achieving the sounds that Les Paul and Mary Ford get. They've got all the tricks down pat, and a lot of them, we can promise, have never yet been recorded. Les has played guitar with Waring's Pennsylvanians. He has been featured on the radio as Rhubarb Red, a hillbilly musician, and he and his wife, Mary, carry around a big bag full of secrets that ensures nothing but bestsellers. You've heard this next bestseller 1,000 times since it was released in March of 1951. But, as with almost everything Nat Cole records, you'll never find yourself tiring of hearing Too Young.
We were not too young at all.
Les Baxter, who at the same time enjoyed a pretty good-sized hit for himself with Because of You, orchestrated and conducted Too Young for Cole. 1951 gave way to another year along about December the 31st, an event which brought 1952, Capitol's 10th birthday anniversary, as well as a platter that was branded a smash by its producers, Voyle Gilmore and Lee Gillette, the very night it was recorded down on Melrose Avenue in Hollywood. Listen for the glass ashtrays being clanked together anvil style throughout the Blacksmith Blues.
Down in old Kentucky, where horseshoes are lucky, there's a village smith that's standing under the chestnut tree.
Back again, Ella Mae Morse with a hit that won't stop after 8 months among the top 10 bestsellers throughout the nation. Nelson Riddle wrote the arrangement and conducted. For Ella Mae, the etching represented a major personal triumph, for she had been inactive for several semesters in order to produce and rear a family, and her dramatic return to records came just a few months short of 10 years since she cranked out, with Freddie Slack's help, Capitol's original Cow Cow Boogie winner. 1952 is far from ended, but it won't be easy to top Blacksmith Blues and another current click, arranged and conducted by Harold Mooney, and featuring the familiar jazz-steep pipes of K-Star.
While the wheel is spinning, 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 I'll not dream of winning fortune or fame.
It's Kay's year, all right. After knocking at the door a dozen times, the Oklahoma-born brunette's own Wheel of Fortune revolved crazily down through the years, then stopped in 52, and right on the right number. Kay's lament and Fool, Fool, Fool will also likely perch atop the year's best-selling list, too, as Capitol, with a full decade of excitement under its belt, gears for another 10 years with the strongest lineup of artists the company has ever assembled. Will there be another Wheel of Fortune, another Cow Cow Boogie early in the next decade, or late, or never? That's a question that probably no one man can answer, but...
I'm sure that's true, but let Capitol's president and number one fan hazard a guess about the next 10 years and try to express, in behalf of a grateful Capitol organization, our company's sincere thanks to the people, the millions of friends who have helped make our little record label of 1942 become the big label of 1952. Capitol will offer an even better product in the future to suit every record buyer's personal requirements on single records and in albums, in the popular and the classical fields alike. To you who buy records, to you dealers who sell them, to the radio jockeys, the reviewers, the coin machine men, count on Capitol. And thank you for the nicest birthday party we've ever had. Bring on the next 10 years.